We can have a relationship with Christianity. We can have a relationship with the church. We can have a relationship with Christian doctrine, but not have a relationship with Christ Himself. You can be born again of the Holy Spirit and yet not be living in relationship, in fellowship with Him.
The good news that God restores us and gives us new life in Christ. Today's message is called the diagnosis of a disease.
Well, good morning. And I'm going to ask you, if you have your Bible, to turn to the book of Isaiah. I'm going to read from chapter 1. I want to read part of the first chapter. I'm going to read the first four verses now. But keep your Bible open if you have one. And if you don't, there may be some in the pew you can use, because I'm going to come back to this passage. We're going to read some more a little later on. But Isaiah chapter 1, verse 1 says, "The vision concerning Judah and Jerusalem that Isaiah, son of Amoz, saw during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Hear, O heavens, listen, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. I reared children and brought them up, but they have rebelled against me. The ox knows its master, the donkey its owner's manger, but Israel does not know. My people do not understand. Our sinful nation, a people loaded with guilt, a brood of evildoers, children given to corruption. They have forsaken the Lord. They have spurned the Holy One of Israel and turned their backs on him." If you visit your doctor, the most important thing you're looking for is an accurate diagnosis of your disease. If you get a wrong diagnosis, you're going to get a wrong remedy. In fact, the Journal of the American Medical Association recently stated that over 40,000 hospital deaths a year in the USA are from misdiagnosed diseases. Now, I don't want to discourage you or to blame your doctor, because medicine is not an exact science. Sometimes it's very difficult to trace the symptoms back to what is the real source and root. I heard about a man who went to visit a psychiatrist one day, sat down in his office and said, "I have a problem. I have this strange feeling. I'm a dog. I keep on thinking I'm a dog. I wake up in the morning and I feel like a dog." The psychiatrist said, "Well, that's rather an unusual symptom. How long have you felt like that?" He said, "Ever since I was a puppy." Well, I want to take you on a visit to the clinic of Dr. Isaiah this morning. Because though there is a long book ahead of him, I think it is fair to say in this opening chapter, he gives a diagnosis of a problem that is going to reoccur with differing symptoms at different times in different situations. But it all derives from one source. And I want to look with you at the diagnosis that he offers, what exactly is wrong with the people, and he's actually addressing the people of Judah. Sometimes he calls them Israel, which is the more generic name for the whole nation that was divided into two nations after the reign of Solomon, Israel in the north, Judah in the south. And although he is addressing Judah, he sometimes refers to them as Israel. And therefore, he is speaking to the people of God, those who are in a covenant relationship with God. And so our purpose in looking at this is not to examine a little bit of Old Testament history, but to discover the truths that are here in principle that apply to the people of Israel, but now apply to the people of God, who form the church of Jesus Christ. God's covenant that we call the old covenant was with Israel. The new covenant, which is international and covers men, women, boys, and girls of every tribe and tongue and color and background, is what we know as the church. So his addressing Israel can equally be superimposed on addressing the church, validly so, and I want to look at it from that point of view. And the diagnosis begins here in verse 3, at least I'll read these verses and we'll come to the diagnosis, where he says, here's an issue, "The ox knows its master, the donkey his own as stranger. But Israel does not know the implication, does not know me. My people do not understand me. And so in the second part of verse 4, he says, they have forsaken the Lord, they have spurned the Holy One of Israel and turned their backs on him. They do not know me. Why? Notice the slippery slope there in the second part of verse 4. They've forsaken the Lord, that is, they've neglected me, and they have spurned the Holy One of Israel and turned their backs on him. Their neglecting him has come to a position of rejecting him, turning their backs away from him. And so what has happened is that there has come a breakdown in the relationship of God with his people. You see, God seeks active relationship with his people, whether it's Israel, whether it's the church. Not just a legal relationship, but you can say, well, we are the people of God. Every Israelite could say that. But you can be in a legal relationship with God that is totally devoid of fellowship and communion, communication, and a sense of living out of a relationship that is real and vital. I have a pen in my pocket, and this pen is of use to me. But I have no relationship with it. I use it, I write with it, I need it, but I don't check it at night to make sure it's lying somewhere comfortable for the night and that the room temperature is okay. It's simply a disposable tool that when it runs out, I can throw it away and get another one. The people of God, not like that. God did not simply select us and bring us into relationship with him so that here's another person I can use. It's a wonderful privilege to be working with God in our world and him working in and through us. But he has brought us in the first instance into relationship with himself that is to be an active, personal, living, day by day, dynamic, fruitful relationship. Jesus defined eternal life in John 17 and verse 3, when he said, this is eternal life. He was speaking to his Father in prayer when he said this. Now, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Not that they may know their eternal destiny changed by you. That is wonderful. Not they may know their sins forgiven. That is wonderful. But the word know there has to do with not just the intellect, but with experiential interaction and involvement with you, that they might know you. So Paul makes it his prayer in Philippians 3 verse 10, I want to know Christ. That's an ever-deepening experience of him. Paul prayed for the Ephesians, Ephesians 1, 17. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation that you may know him better. These are people already Christians. You need to know him better. It's a never-ending, ongoing development of your knowledge of God, your experience of God. The Christian life is not defined by our experiences. They become history a day later. It's not defined by feelings. They may be up, they may be down. That is irrelevant to the real substance of the Christian life. It's not defined by our activities, what we do or what we don't do. But the Christian life is defined by this developing relationship with God. Now, most of us here know that is all part of the lingo of Christianity. We talk perhaps fairly glibly about the fact this is not a religion, this is a relationship we're talking about. But I wonder if we really do live out of a relationship that is living and active with God. We can have a relationship with Christianity. We can have a relationship with the church. We can have a relationship with Christian doctrine and be very concerned about Christian doctrine and measure things against Christian doctrine, but not have a relationship with Christ himself. You can be born again of the Holy Spirit and yet not be living in relationship, in fellowship with him. My wife Hillary and I were talking some weeks ago during the summer. And I was talking about some things that I was dealing with. And she said to me, asked me a very penetrating question. Is Jesus your friend? I started to think about that. And I came to a sober conclusion that my primary relationship with the Lord Jesus is as my business partner. I work with him. I seek to obey him. I seek to trust him. I want to know his mind. I want to know his will. I want to know his word. I want to experience his power. Why? That we can get some things done in his service. And so I said that to her, having thought about it for a while. And she said, yes, I can see that. Make him your friend. It was a very sober realization. And this has been a huge challenge to me, and is and remains an ongoing challenge to me. I've had to readdress some fundamental things in my life. You see, God and Israel had a good business partnership together. God had set them apart. He had called Abraham, took him to Canaan. When he got there, look up at the sky. How many stars can you see? You'll have as many children, descendants as the stars in the sky. And then they went down to Egypt. God brought them back after 400 years in Egypt, by which time they became a nation. He led them through the wilderness, implanted them in Canaan. He gave them godly men and women to lead them amongst the judges. And then when they demanded a king, he gave them eventually David and Solomon and other good kings. And you ask any Israelite person, whose people are you? And they'll tell you, we're the people of God. Why do you live where you live? Because God put us here. God gave us this land. God gave us this place. But in the sense of being in the place that God had put them, they had missed the whole point that God had not simply put them there so that they might feast on the milk and honey. That is going to be a blessing to them and enjoy all the prosperity of the land. God had said to Moses, back in Exodus chapter 19, when they were in the wilderness, in verse 4, he said, "You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt, and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself." That's the ultimate purpose which I brought you, is that I bring you to myself. And then he says that out of all the nations, you are my treasured possession. I have treasure in you out of all the nations of the world. And then he goes on to say that you will be for me a holy nation. For me. So I brought you to myself. I made you my treasured possessions. My treasure is in you. And I am here to enjoy that relationship with you, enjoy that intimacy with you, and enjoy that fellowship with you. You are my set apart, that is my holy nation. And you cannot live that way unless he's your friend. And unless you are developing that friendship and communion with him, that takes time, that takes discipline, that takes intentionality, then all the things that are busy in our lives, that I'm consciously spending time with God. That is true in marriage, of course. You can be so busy in marriage that you no longer spend time with each other. And then you wonder, why is this relationship not very good? Sometimes when I conduct a wedding, I have talked to the couple in the wedding service about togetherness in marriage. And I've sometimes said there are two kinds of togetherness. There's a side-by-side togetherness where you are moving together in life. You've got a purpose and a sense of direction. And others may join you on that journey, and that's fine. You're moving together in the same direction. But there's also a face-to-face togetherness. Nobody joins you there. That is exclusively between the two of you, where you invest in each other, where you take time to know each other's heart, where you're willing to be vulnerable with each other, you're willing to be weak together and not put on a bravado that you might need to put on out in the world. But sometimes we get so occupied with the side-by-side togetherness, our jobs are busy, we have a family to look after, we're looking after the house, we're maintaining things, that we have no time for the face-to-face communication. Yes, we cast a sideways glance every once in a while to each other. Are you doing okay? Yeah, I'm doing okay. But you're not, but that's what you've learned to say, because it's usually the women who think this, he won't listen anyway if I try to tell him. He's too busy. And we can do that with the Lord Jesus Christ. And we can be in a technical relationship with him because we've been born again of the Spirit, but we're not in a practical or a living relationship. And as he says in verse 4, they have forsaken the Lord. They have spurned the Holy One of Israel and turned their back on him. Notice that. Their face-to-face posture has become a back-to-back posture. And he calls them as a result in verse 4, a sinful nation. What is the nature of their sin? Well, of course, there's lots of symptoms. But the essential nature of their sins is their sin, which is their broken fellowship with God. And God, interestingly, speaks here through Isaiah as a father, not as a judge, not as a King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is all of that, but he speaks as a father. He says in verse 2, I reared children and brought them up, but they have rebelled against me. Now, a father's response to sin or rebellion in his child is grief. It's a mistake to think only of God as the judge of our sin, sitting on a judgment bench and measuring everything by the law and judging us accordingly. But this here is not the attitude of a judge. This is the attitude of a father. You see, a judge can take this in his stride. He knows what he has to do. He can listen to all the cases that come before him, look at the law and see where they fall foul of the law and pass down judgment accordingly. Next case, next one comes in. Next case, he goes home, has his dinner and sleeps well. This is part of the job. He's not emotionally connected at all. But a father doesn't do that. A father will weep over the sins of his children, as God does. I read to you last week, Genesis 6:6. The Lord was grieved that he had made man on the earth, and his heart was filled with pain. Grief and pain are the words used to describe God in his attitude to sin. This is a response of love. You see, grief is the price we pay for love. If you don't love, you won't grieve. If I look in the obituary column in a newspaper and see a dozen names, I can pass it aside and read something else very quickly. I'm not connected. But if somebody I know and loves dies, I experience grief. And God speaks about grief in this passage. When Isaiah writes that brilliant chapter 53, foreseeing the crucifixion of Christ and explaining the crucifixion of Christ, 600 years before it ever took place. In fact, before crucifixion was ever devised as a form of capital punishment. In describing Jesus in Isaiah 53, he describes him as a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Not feeling sorry for himself, because now I'm taking the sins of the world. No. But he went to the cross bearing our sin as a man of sorrows and a man of grief. That is God's attitude towards us that causes him to become sorrowful and grieving over our sin. Because I brought you to myself, and you're not in fellowship with me. You're not in communion with me. Let me ask you, you're a Christian. When you last spend time just alone with Jesus, just talking with him. As my friend Hans-Peter Royer from Austria, who's been here to speak a few times, as he has said when he's been here, go and have a cup of coffee with Jesus. That's not being flippant. And just stop everything and just enjoy him. He said to the church in Laodicea, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man open the door," this is to the church, "if you open the door, I will come in and do what? I will sup with you. I'll sit down and eat with you. Fellowship with you. Commune with you." And when he says in verse 3 that the ox knows his master and the donkey his owner's manger, but Israel does not know, my people don't understand, that begs the question, how does an ox know his master? How does a donkey know its owner's manger? Well, I'll tell you how. By familiarity. I mean, the ox doesn't know from a crowd of people, who do I belong to? But as the owner works with the ox and they become familiar, he learns to recognize his smell, recognize his shape, recognize his gait, recognize his voice. It's by familiarity. And we need to become familiar with the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, we can know God's truth, but not know his voice. His voice, he whispers in our hearts. Isaiah said, and I read this verse to you last week, "The Lord has given me an instructed tongue to know the word that sustains the weary. Morning by morning, he opens my ear to listen. And because he opens my ear, my tongue is instructed." And you know an instructed tongue because it actually sustains the weary. It doesn't heap stuff on them, it lifts them. And the basic diagnosis that is made of the people of Israel, and this is a recurring diagnosis all the way through Isaiah, they've forsaken me, they've forgotten me. Turn to Jeremiah, they've forsaken me and they've dug out cisterns. They've forsaken me, the fountain of living water, and they've dug out cisterns, broken cisterns that hold no water. When they forsake me, they always look for other things. But the problem is other things are always drained. They're broken cisterns that hold no water. It's true in the Christian life. I know how easily it becomes true in my life. I know what a challenge and wake-up it was for me when Hillary said to me, "Is he your friend?" And I thought, oh boy. I've been side by side and not face to face. So what are the consequences of this? What are the symptoms? How does this express itself? Let me read you verse 11 down to verse 15. He says there, the multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me, says the Lord? I have more than enough for burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fattened animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to appear before me, who has asked this of you, this trampling of my courts? Stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. New moons, Sabbaths, and convocations, I cannot bear your evil assemblies, your new moon festivals and your appointed feasts. My soul hates. They become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you spread out your hands in prayer, I'll hide my eyes from you. Even if you offer many prayers, I will not listen. This is an extremely discouraging passage, and I'll tell you why. Those things in the main that he's talking about are things that God ordained. He speaks of the sacrifices, the burnt offerings, the rams, and the fat of animals, the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. He talks about incense. He talks about praying. All these were things ordained by God, but he says, I am sick of them. I am weary of them. Why? Because these activities, designed and given by God, were activities that were designed to point to something else. They were rituals designed to point to a reality. So in the blood of bulls and goats and rams, etc., it was demonstrating when they brought these to the temple in Jerusalem and the priest offered them. And once a year, the blood of bulls and lambs were taken into the Holy of Holies. They were demonstrating both the holiness of God and his need for atonement and the sinfulness of human beings and their need that atonement should be made in order to be reconciled to God. Now, the rituals were these acts, but the reality to which it pointed was reconciliation with God and fellowship with God. But what happens when the ritual stops pointing to a reality is that the ritual will replace the reality, and the all-important thing no longer becomes God's holiness and his need for atonement and our sinfulness and our need for cleansing. The all-important thing becomes the ritual itself. As long as I have done it, as long as I've turned up at the temple, as long as I've produced the right animal on the right day at the right time and said the right things, it itself is good. God says, no, it isn't. Because the ritual only has value as it points to the reality. But take away the reality and the ritual itself becomes dead. But it happens all the time. It can happen with us. Under the new covenant, we don't have rituals like under the old covenant because they were all satisfied fully in Christ. The moment he died and the curtain was torn from top to the bottom, and God was no longer confined to that little space and approached only by a priest. He was now available to all people in all places at all times. But there are symbols we're given in the New Testament that we engage in that point to something else. For instance, the communion, the Lord's Supper. Jesus in the upper room said to his disciples, taking some bread, this is my body, it is for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. He took a cup with wine. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Drink this in remembrance of me. Now, the symbols of the bread and the wine, the ritual is the eating and the drinking of them, but the reality to which they point is me. So when you take these, there's no virtue in the bread, there's no virtue in the wine. It's that they are reminders and pointers back to me. But supposing you don't know Christ, can you still take part in communion? Well, yes, many do. And what happens? Instead of the ritual pointing to the reality, what will happen is the ritual will replace the reality, and the all-important thing becomes not am I living in fellowship with him and remembering him. The all-important thing becomes have I had it? And we become superstitious about the bread and the wine. When I was in Glasgow studying there, I went to a Church of Scotland in the middle of the city. They had a good ministry there, and the Church of Scotland have communion four times a year, once every 3 months. And if you enter that church on Communion Sunday, they had to put on an extra service on Sunday afternoon to accommodate the crowds who turned up because it was Communion Sunday. And if you were visiting it, you'd think they were having revival, but they weren't. This was superstitious Christians coming out of the woodwork four times a year to get it, thinking it somehow will do something for me. It won't do anything for you. It is designed to be a pointer to the Lord Jesus Christ and detach it from him and become an end in itself. And God says of that here in Isaiah, I hate it. They make me weary. They make me tired. They make me sick. And taken to its extreme, you end up with transubstantiation, where the bread becomes the body, the wine becomes the blood. What nonsense. What about baptism? Beautiful picture. Be baptized by immersion, based on Romans chapter 6, a picture of identification with Christ in his death, down into the water, his burial under the water, his resurrection to walk in newness of life. Now, baptism doesn't make that happen, doesn't unite you to Christ. Baptism is simply a picture. All baptism does is make you wet. But it's a picture. It's like a wedding ring. I have a wedding ring. And my wife gave me this on our wedding day and said with it used to come off. Came off in the first service. What's happened since then? I don't know. With this ring, I thee wed. You know, that's the language. But this is just a symbol. I'm not married if I take it off. It's just a symbol, in case anybody's curious. Are you fixed or not? Baptism is like a wedding ring. It's saying, I belong to Jesus Christ. It's a public demonstration of that. Other people see baptism more as an engagement ring where they baptize usually children in the hope that one day this child will come to know Christ for themselves. And we're not going to discuss the merits of those particular positions which have been there in the whole history of the Christian church. But the point is this, baptism is only valid as it points to our union with Christ. But if you're not united with Christ, can you be baptized? Yes, people are. And what happens? Instead of the ritual pointing to the reality, the ritual replaces the reality. And the all-important thing becomes not, are you walking in union with Christ, but have you been done? Do you have a certificate on your wall to say you were done on a certain date? I was baptized at the age of 16 in the village in which I lived, in the little church I went to. They announced there was going to be a baptism service a few weeks ahead because somebody had asked to be baptized. And we were a little church. We didn't have a baptistry. We had to borrow another church. And we were to go to this other church to have this baptism. And they announced it and said, if anybody is not yet baptized and would like to be baptized, let us know because you can be baptized on the same day. And at the end of that service, one of the elders said to me, you're a Christian, aren't you? I said, yes. Have you been baptized? No. Have you thought about it? And actually, I had. I've been thinking about it. Well, then why don't you get baptized with this batch? It'll save having to borrow the church again, having to heat up the tank. And so there were about six of us all together who got baptized that night. And I remember being baptized and coming out of the tank, feeling like a drenched rat, and going into a room at the back to get changed and saying to myself, what in the world is that all about? I remember thinking that at 16. Nobody said to me, do you know what it is to be crucified with Christ? I would have said, I'd love to explain it to me. To be buried with him, to be risen, to walk in newness of life. My brother, who was 18 months older than me, was baptized that same night. To this day, he's not a Christian. But he's been done. Taken to its extreme, you get baptismal regeneration, where the act of baptism makes you a child of God. What nonsense. You see, the purpose of the ritual, the purpose of the symbol, is to point to a reality. When I became a Christian, I was told I should read my Bible. That was very good advice. But I wasn't told why I should read my Bible, and I thought that the purpose of reading the Bible was to get to know the Bible. Then I discovered, well, I wondered why it was so dry, But then I discovered that Jesus criticized people for studying the Bible in John 5:39 when he said, "You diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life, but these are the scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life." So you do not study the Bible to get to know the Bible. You study the Bible to get to know Christ. That's the purpose. You can know the Bible back to front and not know Christ. Hillary and I have a Toyota RAV, which we got about a year ago, and I drove it in this morning. She's not here. She's in Australia this weekend. That's why I can refer to her a lot. No, I told her I was going to tell you what I've just told you about her, what she said to me in the summer, but she's speaking at a conference this weekend and another one next weekend for ladies. But I drove in this morning in our Toyota RAV, and when we got it a year ago, it came with an instruction manual, which I looked at. It's wise to do that. And the reason why I read the instruction manual was not because I wanted to know all about the instruction manual. I had a better reason. I wanted to know all about the car. Now, of course, I could have studied the instruction manual. I could have read a little bit every night before I went to bed. I could have underlined the bits that I liked. I could have put it to music and sung it. I could have joined the local Toyota fellowship and gone for an exposition of the manual. This week's subject, spark plugs. Next week's subject, tire pressures. If I was a fanatic, I could have studied Japanese to read the manual in the original language. That would impress everybody. I could say, well, the Japanese for this means such and such. And everybody would believe me because they wouldn't know any different. But the day would come, having read the manual, memorized it, sung it, underlined it, put it to music and sung it, studied Japanese. The day would come, I'd say, I am bored with this manual. Why? Because the purpose of the manual is I might know the car. There's no virtue in knowing the manual. There's no virtue in knowing the scripture. There's only virtue in knowing Christ. And scripture is the means by which we come to know him. You study the scriptures, he told the Jews, because you think in them you'll have life. But they bear witness to me, and you don't come to me. So what do you become? You become Pharisees. And so the whole purpose of the written word is we know the living word. The ritual of reading the Bible every day, which is a good discipline, spending time in the Word of God, as you get to know Christ. You understand God. You understand more fully the revelation he gives of himself. And so the symptom of becoming detached from God, when it comes to Christianity, the symptom of becoming out of fellowship with God is that Christianity becomes the all-important thing, or the church becomes the all-important thing, or dotting your I's and crossing your T's becomes the all-important thing. And all those things are valid, every bit as these were valid, sacrifices and offerings. But they become an end in themselves. So what's the remedy? Let me read you from verse 18 to verse 20. And he says there, "Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. If you're willing and obedient, you will eat the best from the land. But if you resist and rebel, you will be devoured by the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." Notice he says, come, let us reason together. What do you think that means? It means look me in the eye. Turn back to me. When my kids were small, especially my son, if I had to discipline him, I'd often say, "Matthew, look at me. Look me in the eye." And when I had his full attention, I'd tell him what I had to tell him. What's happened to these people is that the face-to-face has become a back-to-back, turn their backs on me. Now he says, come, let's reason. Turn around and look at me. reconnect with me. And this let us reason together is an incredible picture of the graciousness of God here. And these people have brought their bulls, their rams, their lambs, their goats. They'd engaged in all the sacrifices and the burnt offerings, but they had done it all on automatic pilot. It was on the schedule. They simply did it because it was the right day of the week. It was the right event, the right festival, the right sacrifice, and they just did it like clockwork, but they never engaged with God himself. And you know, that can happen so easily in the Christian life. Reason. And as you turn to reason, you reconnect, you reestablish the fellowship, the relationship. You know, we outsource a lot of things in our lives, and it's very easy to outsource our spiritual life. You know, some of you may have a lawyer to deal with your legal issues. You have an accountant to deal with your finances and your taxes. We have a doctor to deal with our medical issues. And we can have a church to deal with our spiritual issues. We simply outsource it. We don't deal with God. We might hope somebody else will deal with God on our behalf. Tell me when in the Bible Paul ever said, "Send me your prayer requests and I'll pray for you." When did any of the prophets, in sending out their prophetic messages, say, "If you have any prayer needs, send them to me, and I, Isaiah, will pray for you"? Who in the world do you think you are, Isaiah? But there are pastors who say that. I hear them on television. "Send me your prayer." Who in the world do they think they are? You and I have equal access through the blood of Christ right into the throne room of heaven. Now, it's good to pray for one another, but you see, he says, "Come to me, reason with me, and I'll tell you what I'll do. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they're red as crimson, they'll be like wool." Earlier in the passage, he's talked about our sinful nature, a people loaded with guilt, a brood of evildoers, children given to corruption. What are you talking about? I'm talking about you. But that's not the end word. That's not the last word on you. Here's the last word. Though your sins are like scarlet, they'll be as white as snow. That, by the way, doesn't happen in a washing machine. Something scarlet doesn't become white. You spill tomato juice on a white shirt and you're in trouble. This is a miracle of God. I'll transform you. And though your sins are red like crimson, they'll be like wool. That takes the miracle of God. He says, "Look, just turn to me, reason together. Let's talk to you face to face. Look at me. Listen to me. I'll cleanse you. If you come back into fellowship with me, come back into a living, active relationship with me." And then he says in verse 19, "If you're willing and obedient, you'll eat the best of the land." You remember the attraction of Canaan, the reason why he told them this was worth going through the wilderness for? It's a land, he said, flung with milk and honey, most fertile territory in the Middle East. And he said, "If you come back to me and we are face to face again in relationship and friendship and fellowship and communion, I'll forgive and cleanse you, make you as white as snow, and you will benefit from all the best of the land." All of that will take place in the context of a relationship that is active. You see, if our relationship is not right with God, all the promises he gives you in the Word of God trip over that problem. They don't come to fruition unless we are those who have come in confession. We're cleansed, and he then imparts to us all the fullness of Christ that enables us to live with all the battles that still go on, all the temptations we struggle with all the time, but we live fruitfully. I don't know how God may have spoken to you this morning, but Dr. Isaiah's diagnosis is you've turned away from God. You're the people of God, but you're not in fellowship with Him. The symptoms are you have engaged in all these religious activities, and they themselves have become the all-important thing now because you're detached from the reality to which they point. But come, let's reason together. Come and talk to me. Let's engage in communion. Let's engage in fellowship. And I'll forgive you. And the land will give you the best of what it has to offer. And if that was true for Israel, it remains true for so many of us as believers. As I have studied this, and I've shared a bit of myself in so doing with you this morning, but you know, it's been both painful and therapeutic at the same time. Because there's always a way home. Now, Father, we thank you from our hearts this morning. By your Holy Spirit, you're always calling us back, calling us home. And I pray, Lord, for each person here this morning, for those of us who know that we have wandered, that our relationship with you is not fresh, it's not living, it's not dynamic, it's become stale. Lord, bring us home. Home to your heart, home to yourself. For those of us who don't know you, as by the Holy Spirit you've spoken to them, bring them into this living relationship with yourself for the first time and give them the joy of knowing that they are home with you. May the Spirit of God bear witness with their spirits that they are children of God, reconciled to you forever. And give us that discipline, focused intention that we keep the face-to-face relationship with you alive. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation. Tune in again next week when Charles Price continues his series on Isaiah with a message called Experiencing the Holiness of God. Christ in
you. The prophet Isaiah told the people of Israel things they needed to know but didn't want to hear. He told them there was a price to pay for disobedience. But he also told them how God offers comfort, hope, and salvation when people return to Him. The 8-part series, Isaiah Calling People Home, gives the good news that God restores us and gives us new life in Christ. The Isaiah series is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. Write to Living Truth to order by mail or call +1-416-222-3341 extension 113 or contact us through our website livingtruth.ca. Isaiah Calling People Home shows how God gives us hope for the future.
Jesus loves me, this I